Good evening. I'm Jonathan Fanton, the interim director of Roosevelt House, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to a very special evening. Many of you are frequent guests here, and you have been here to hear Jeff Sachs talk about his book, To Move the World, or hear UNDP Director Helen Clark. And next week, we encourage you to come and hear a conference on John Lindsay, or kind of reassessment of his time as mayor. So that'll be good. But tonight is a different kind of evening. I've long wanted to have a series of conversations with the most interesting people that I know personally. Ed Koch was my first guest, followed by former MoMA President Agnes Gund, Jim Lipton of Inside the Actors Studio, Vartan Gregorian of the Carnegie Foundation, Judy Collins, that was a great evening, and most recently, former HUW Secretary Joe Califano. My guest tonight is my friend and mentor, Elizabeth McCormack. We first met when she was working for John D. Rockefeller and I for Yale President Kingman Brewster. As our two bosses talked about establishing a center at Yale for the study of the not-for-profit sector, Elizabeth and I chatted in her office in room 5600 at 30 Rock. We clicked immediately. The chemistry was magic, and years later, when I returned to New York as president of the New School, she tutored me on the art of being a college president. So fast forward 17 years, she was on the search committee looking for a new president of the MacArthur Foundation. She was my advocate, and it was no surprise, I got the job. So for nearly four decades, she has been my most trusted advisor. I never make an important move without seeking her advice. And we continue to make common cause on the board of the Asian Cultural Council, and together with my wife Cynthia and her late husband Jerry, we've had a wonderful and deep friendship. She earned her BA at Manhattanville College and a PhD in philosophy at Fordham. In her senior year at Manhattanville, she joined the Order of the Sacred Heart and soon after began teaching at its schools, Kenwood in Albany and later in Greenwich. And in 1962, she became Dean of Manhattanville. And then quickly rising to president in 1966, she led Manhattanville, really transformed it from an elite Catholic women's institution into a non-denominational co-ed college. And after Manhattanville, she became director of the Rockefeller Philanthropy offices and remains an advisor to some members of the family. She's had about as active a civic life as anyone I know. She chaired, as I say, the Asian Cultural Council for 20 years, was vice chair and then vice chair of the MacArthur Board, a key member of the board of the Atlantic Philanthropies, a member of the boards of Manhattanville, Spelman, Marlborough, and Hamilton Colleges, also Juilliard School. She's been on the boards of the Population Council, the Trust for Mutual Understanding, the Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, and recently started the Partnership for Palliative Care, which is her current major interest. And this is all in one lifetime. Bill Moyers described her life beautifully when he said, and I quote, Elizabeth McCormack reminds us of the things that last, that transcend the tumult of the hour and the news of the day. Her life is about connections and continuities between past and present, between now and future, between the natural world and the world we make together. So said Bill Moyers. Those qualities I saw close up at the MacArthur Foundation, which she has the surest instinct for philanthropy of anybody I know, a laser insight into people, and the ability to visualize a grant strategy in fields as diverse as population, education, and the environment. At the conclusion of her term at MacArthur, I said this, she loves to build institutions, strengthen their governance, clarify their purpose, improve their quality, and extend their influence in pursuit of a more just and humane world of peace. We have benefited from her deep experience in how things really work. Her impatience with fuzzy thinking has lifted our standards, saved us from not a few missteps, and made this a better foundation. So all this we're going to explore. She and I will talk for, let's say, 45 minutes or so, and then we'll open it up to your questions, and we'll be done promptly at 7:20. So think of your questions. Elizabeth, come and join me.
This is the challenge to get in. Oh, it's not bad.
Not bad. Not bad. Well,
I wouldn't do this for many people, but I do it for Jonathan.
Well, as I said to Liz, you know, I work at this for a bit, and Mike Sovereign will be in that seat coming up. So I have lots of questions, more than we can get through. But our plan is to have a good time and just talk. And so I'm going to warm us up with a couple questions, most of which, by the way, Elizabeth has not heard, so she'll be hearing them as you do. But I did tell her the first one. You have been a mentor to me and others. Who were your mentors?
Well, my first mentor was a nun, Mother Elizabeth Cavanaugh. She taught me, and I admired her. She had a brilliant mind, and whatever it means to be a good nun, she was one. And then later, when I came to work for the Rockefellers, I looked for a mentor in philanthropy, and I found it in John D. Rockefeller III. He was a real philanthropist, knew what he was doing, and never, never tried to control the organizations that he funded.
You have said, do not be beguiled into assuming that we give and receive. Instead, we meet and change one another. Whom did you meet who changed you?
The man I married. people, everyone we meet changes us. But Jerry Aron changed me, made me a lot better. Really changed me.
And yeah, a couple of examples.
Well, when we learned to know one another at the college, I was still a nun. And people began saying we were having an affair, which was good talk. but it just plain wasn't true. And I said to him, this is disturbing. He said, you've got to learn not to be disturbed by what people say, even if it's true. And when it isn't, you should not be disturbed. He taught me how to live and how to act according to principle, even when the people you were with had different principles, but respected you for having yours.
Tell us something about your parents, how they shaped your worldview, and about your brother George, who became a leading doctor, and I think the two of you were quite close.
I had wonderful parents. My mother went through high school and then taught in a school. My father had one brother, and my father's father died when my father would have been in high school. He dropped out of school and supported his parents and educated himself by reading, but always was, worried about the fact that he was not really educated. And, that's part of the story. that will come in when we talk about Manhattanville. I announced at dinner one night when I was in the third year of high school, I'm going to Radcliffe. And he said, that's very interesting. Have you found the person who'll pay the tuition? Because in those days, if you were a Roman Catholic, you went to a Roman Catholic college. And so I applied at Manhattanville, and he and I went in for the interview, which was with the then president, Mother Grace Damon, and we met in her office. And Dad knew a lot, because he'd read a lot, but he always felt he didn't know much. She began showing us pictures in her office of Jacques Maritain, who was a French Catholic philosopher about whom my father had never heard. So he felt that he failed that interview, which of course he didn't. But when we got in the car to go home, he said to me, Betty, who the hell is Maritain? And I, of course, said, you don't have to know him. He's known at this moment, but he's not a great thinker. If she had pictures of Plato, or even Thomas Aquinas, but Maritain, you don't have to know.
And your brother?
And my mother had gone through high school, and they both were great readers. And my mother, we always had living with us. First her parents, because her mother had had a stroke when she was in her 40s, and she couldn't have married if they didn't live with us. So they did, her parents. They were okay. Then my father's mother, after they died, was a very demanding woman. And she also lived in Larchmont. And he had to stop in her apartment on his way home. He eventually became the head of an architectural firm that designed banks. That's what he did. And so my grandmother McCormack lived there and was difficult. We had people working for us, and she tried to control them and boss them. And I said to my mother one day, you've got to tell Dad. He can talk to his mother. And she said, his work is in New York City. This is my work, and I'm not bothering him with it. That was a pretty good example.
And your brother, George?
My brother became a doctor and went to Holy Cross and was going to Georgetown. But Dad looked into medical schools and decided Georgetown was good, but P&S, Columbia, was better, and so said, you don't have to go to a Catholic college. You've had all that. He was a great doctor.
Growing up in college, what did you like to read? What do you like to read now? Tell us about you and books.
I find if you read the New York Review of Books and the New Yorker and you're busy, you're not always reading a book, but I'm reading right now a very good book that someone gave me that's called The Citizens of London, and it's about World War II and Harriman and Edward R. Morrow and a man that's an interesting part of the book. He was the governor of New Hampshire. I read his name but never said it. And he became the head of Social Security, which was just created by Roosevelt, and the arguments sound very like Obamacare. Horror in the country. What are we becoming with Social Security? A socialist country, that's what was being said.
My recollection, having read your autobiography, is that, you became a Democrat fairly early, or you identified as a Democrat when you were 7 or 8. were you politically active in high school and college? And, and who were some of your political heroes and heroines?
I became a Democrat because the grandfather, my mother's father, who lived with us, was blind when he was quite young. And I read the Herald Tribune to him every day. As soon as I could read, I read him the newspaper. And I would read the headline, and he would tell me what to continue to read. And I read all the editorials. And when I was about 10, I decided, I don't believe what I'm reading in this paper. I'm a Democrat. So it was reading the Herald Tribune years ago that made me a Democrat. In those days, we were not active politically. Uh-huh. My mother used to say to my father, you know, we don't have to vote because you vote Republican and I vote Democrat and we cancel one another. And I can remember him saying, that does not free us from voting. We have to vote.
Well, overhead are Eleanor and Franklin Roosevelt behind us. What were your feelings about them as you were growing up? And were there other political figures that were role models or heroes?
I admired FDR, without any doubt. And a nun who taught me, Mother Tenney was her name, and she taught me. And I remember saying to someone, she doesn't say she's a Democrat, but she is. And we better remember it when we answer the questions on tests. What did you ask?
Well, I just asked other political figures who were kind of inspirational to you as you...
Well, you know, it's a long time ago.
Yeah, well, even currently.
Oh, currently?
Well, just at any point in your lifetime.
Well, I really learned to be political at Manhattanville because I was there as the president during difficult times. Campuses were very political. In fact, today, I kind of miss that on campuses. Very little real interest. But in those days, there was more than interest. There was fighting on the subject against the war in Vietnam. That caused most of this, and the civil rights movement. So I always said after it that the way that students showed their political positions was not good. And they took over buildings. And they took over a big academic building at Manhattanville. And shows you something about me. The first thing I did was phone the local police and said, no matter who asks you to come to this campus, you are not to do it unless I phone. And I never will. So I went into the building, which had been taken, through a window, and three nights. And the first night, I was nervous. And as I climbed in, it was a window that opened like this, and you had to go up and over and in. I heard one student say to another, don't let her fall. And I thought, wow, this is going to be fine. So I heard more. I never heard a four-letter word in my my life up to that moment. But I heard plenty of them and took a lot of abuse and simply said no. Their demands were made so outrageous that you couldn't possibly do what they said. There were maybe 30 black students. They demanded 300. There may have been five black faculty. They demanded 25. But after a few nights, I thought, you know, over the weekend, some of their friends from Harlem might come, and this could get dangerous. So I've got to put a stop to it. So I thought, the next thing anybody says, whatever it is, I will take exception to it. Someone of the students said, you come here so benevolently. And I took my hands and hit the table. So it came up. I said, I will not be called benevolent. And they all said in unison, we're sorry.
In the introduction to your...
And that group who took over that building, almost to every one of them, about 10 years ago, had a luncheon for me at the Cosmopolitan Club. So whatever we did, if you call that progress, I guess it is, we did well.
Good. In his introduction to your biography, our mutual friend Joel Fleischman said this, the secret to Elizabeth McCormack's success is her ever-ready frankness. She honestly and clearly expresses her views, and she can be blunt if necessary. She offers advice without regard to any personal self-interest, and with a genuineness, vision, consistency, and gutsiness. All of this is always done in a respectful and balanced manner, with humility, gentleness, and grace. She is wise, never self-righteous.
That's kind of baloney, but...
Well, I was going to ask you, assuming some of that is true, where did those qualities come from?
I try not to bring to what I do with people my agenda. I try not to do that. I try to have the agenda that the group has and we're trying to do. And I think when you're able to do that, you can be pretty influential. I remember one of the Rockefellers, J.D. Arthur's daughter, Elida, said to me, if this were your money, what would you do with it? And I said, that's a secret. I'll never tell you. And she said, is it what I'm doing? Maybe, but it never was.
I'm going to come a little bit more back to that in a moment. There's a scholarship in your name at Manhattanville, and on the website, there's a quote from Helen Keller. And Helen Keller said, life is either a daring adventure or nothing at all. So what adventures were most challenging in your life, and how do you think about risk?
I think the most interesting thing is other people. I have found great happiness, not just with my friends, but with people. And I think when people say, in all these years, what have you done? It's a really hard question. I'm not much. But I think I have made life, which is difficult, quite a bit easier for a lot of people, just by being nice. And it gets to be a habit.
So to speak.
Including. And then the people make you happy.
Yeah. Now, after Manhattanville, you became a teacher at Kenwood and at Greenwich, and then eventually you were...
Someone's here, right in the front row,
yeah.
Who I taught way back then at Kenwood.
And then you were headmistress, I think, of Greenwich.
Mm-hmm.
You were headmistress of Greenwich,
yes.
For a while. So what do you think back to those days as a teacher and headmistress? What did you learn about running organizations? And did you have a sense then that you had leadership ability that should be...
I never thought about that.
Yeah.
You know. What amazed me when I became headmistress at Greenwich, I was young. And I knew very little. And immediately, once you had that job, parents trusted you. And they phoned with problems with their children, with concerns they had. And I can remember thinking, I've got to learn how to do this, because people think I can do it. And I followed a nun who had been my teacher, a Mother Helen Burke, who was very demanding of everybody. And when I became head, she left the school and I took over in Greenwich, Connecticut. And one day I saw a young nun looking distressed. Well, in the Sacred Heart schools, one day was the mistress general, the headmistress, feast day. And this nun said to me, the children are putting on this play in honor of you 3 days from now, and they don't know their parts. And I'm very concerned. I said, what are you concerned about? Well, it's going to upset you. I said, who do you think I am? That I care if little children don't know their parts? Well, they said, Mother Burke would have cared. And I said, not Mother Burke. And so I found running a place, you have to be good to everybody, and you have to be demanding, but in a nice way.
And then you went to Fordham, got a PhD, and I realize that you and T.S. Eliot have something in common. You both wrote dissertations on F.H. Bradley.
Yes, we do.
Who is F.H. Bradley?
I'll send you the thesis. And then, now, what happened was I took courses from a magnificent philosopher, Robert Pollock. And Robert Pollock, I took every course he gave. And he always sent me my grade for papers, but he never returned a paper. Never. And when I'd finished everything, comprehensives, language, everything, he phoned me. And he said, I hear you're finished everything but the dissertation. So I reread all your papers. I said, I'm glad they had some use. And he said, well, you think like the British philosopher F.H. Bradley, a British Platonist early in the 1900s. He said, you think like him, you'll find writing about him very easy. So that's what I did. And I don't think now I'd understand it.
Well, you wrote, my own view of the, about Pollock, my own view of the universe altered. He had a much more complex notion of reality and the realization that everything that is real is related to everything else.
Yeah.
You can't think of yourself as just an individual. To be is to be related.
Yeah. That was Bradley.
Yeah, that was Bradley.
Where did I say that?
I think you told it to your biographer. Now, you then were dean of Manhattanville, and as we heard, and quickly rose up to being president. And I wonder whether Manhattanville knew what it was getting into when it made you president. You told your biographer, "I had come to believe that the idea of a Catholic, capital C, liberal arts colleges was kind of a contradiction." And then you made a very dramatic announcement on September 21st, 1970. You said Manhattanville would begin admitting men in the fall of 1971. You said our students live in a world of men and women and therefore should be educated in an environment that reflects the concerns of both sexes. So dropping Sacred Heart from the name, going co-ed, earned you a lot of criticism, and those were bold moves. Of the criticism, what got to you?
Well, I always say my blood is still on the ground.
And who supported you? And looking back, how did co-education work out?
Well, I had talked about this at great length to the nun who was my superior, Mother Helen Fitzgerald. You see, Manhattanville was a first-rate college, and its students were excellent because the Catholic Church demanded that Catholics go to Catholic colleges. That was stopping, and therefore the pipeline to the college was just disappearing. And therefore, it seemed to me that the way to open it to a different group of, well, a different group, not Roman Catholics necessarily, was the way to keep it alive. And that's what I did. And the hardest part of that, which will shock a lot of you, I, with one of the young nuns, went into every classroom in the dark of night and took down the crucifixes, which was really very hard to do. However, I didn't have to change anything legally. The college was never church-related, never. It was had a board that was lay people and a few nuns, and the faculty were not Catholic necessarily, but the nuns predominated and were great. And of course they were Catholic. But that number, there isn't a single nun on the Manhattanville campus now, because there aren't many nuns left. And they don't get PhDs. So it the circumstances made the changes.
And did the criticism, you got a lot of criticism, didn't you?
Did what?
A lot of criticism from alumni?
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
Sure. And you learned, I learned at the college that no matter what decision you made, you had to act according to principle because you would upset some group, faculty, students, alumni. You were bound to upset people by your decisions. And in the archives of the college are the letters that came after those decisions. And the one that I'll never forget was a picture of a stained glass window, and the stained glass window was a picture of Judas kissing Jesus, and it said under it, "This is you, sister." And my thought was, does the person who wrote that think she's Christian? You don't do that.
You mentioned Jerry earlier, and you and Jerry had a great working relationship at Manhattanville.
Yeah.
And he said something very nice summing up your tenure at Manhattanville, and these are Jerry's words. "Her whole life has been the management of trends, which is an extremely difficult thing to do. And one of the key elements you have to have in order to do that is flat-out courage. You have to be able to walk in standing up straight and say it. And you have to think thoughts that your contemporaries are afraid to even mention. You have to think them, say them, and do them. And that's what she did. That's how she salvaged Manhattanville College and got 5,000 women hating her. So, last question on Manhattanville. Sort of looking back over your tenure there, what do you, obviously you're proud of the changes you made. Were there some disappointments? Have you had a couple things to do over again? Would you have done anything differently?
The decision was either change it or close it. And a few colleges, started by Religious of the Sacred Heart, Newton College, closed. So but it's different. It's not the same, because the Catholics who could have gone to Radcliffe for religious reasons came to Manhattanville. That does not happen anymore.
So basically, it was the right decision. It worked out, and Manhattanville has done well.
It's there.
Yeah.
I had an interesting experience. Manhattanville was a very open college. It wasn't all Roman Catholic teachers, and that it was very open to ideas. It was not rigid in any sense. And I was sent to get an MA at Providence College and Dominican College in Rhode Island, which was the opposite. It was rigorously Roman Catholic. And when I had my oral examination for the MA there, the priests, the president walked in during the examination, a Father Slavin, and the priests asked me all the hard questions, and I knew the answers. But for about five of them, I prefaced my answer saying, I have been taught at Providence College. And the president recognized what I was doing. So when it was over and I clearly passed, he called me over and he said, Sister, you prefaced many of your answers. You have been taught. Did you mean you don't believe what you said? I said, that's right, Father, I don't believe it. And he said, and I'll never forget it, you're honest, but you're wrong.
Well, on January 14th, 1974, you wrote a letter to your friends that said in part, I have asked and have been authorized to leave the Society of the Sacred Heart. I came to this decision with sadness, and after several years of reflection, the world in which we live is dynamic. It's inevitable that both institutions and individuals evolve as they moved, as are moved by the forces of life. So you have read, I think, Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot's book, The Exit, which she talked about here. And she talks about leaving relationships as a form of liberation, but also involving loss. Take us back. Talk to us about that decision and how you felt as you exited the Society of the Sacred Heart.
Well, I was elected to go to a general chapter of the order in Rome. And I had never had a question about anything. But the Mother General, elected for life, was clearly psychotic. Clearly. And there were 44 members of the chapter, and while a chapter is functioning, it's the governing body, and I became appalled that unless someone did something, we would leave this sick woman ahead of 8,000 nuns all over the world. So I studied everyone at the chapter and chose three very gifted women, one from Great Britain, one from this country, and one from Holland. And I called them together and I said, you must know we've got a huge problem and we can't vote because nobody is going to vote to remove her. We've got to go to the cardinal. We were not under bishops, but we were under a cardinal. You three have to go, and you'll come. I said, no, I won't. I was the youngest person there. I'm not going to come. You're going to go. They did, told the story, and he came and spoke to the chapter, and we all had our simultaneous translation, and he made a pious, beautiful speech. And then he said to her, who's right there with him, I ask you for your resignation. And she said, oui, mon père, end of problem. And it was very moving because she had learned obedience. But that chapter made me begin to think, what is this group? Why did I have to do that? And then for the next 4 or 5 years, I questioned, talking to nobody about it, whether to stay with this. And by the end of, well, it was in the 70s, I became president in 66. This was in the 70s, early 70s. I had decided, and of course, everyone said, not everyone, most people, it was because of the man I married. Not true. Before I ever met him, I was thinking about this. But what I can say was when I finally did it, his existence made it pretty easy.
Yes. How did life change after you got married? Did you see the world differently, relate to people differently?
I don't think so.
Yeah.
No.
But you and Jerry traveled a lot, I think. And
we did.
Tell us a story or two of something that was particularly meaningful or fun.
Well, some people here knew Jerry. I can't describe him. But he was great. And we had fun.
Yeah, well, we knew him and we loved him, and he was great. Shortly after announcing that you were going to leave Manhattanville, you got a call from, I think, Bill Deedle, asking you about maybe coming to work for the Rockefellers. How did you get connected to the Rockefellers?
Well,
what was your assignment there?
I was invited when I still knew about colleges. I was at Manhattanville, and I was invited with the president of Colonial Williamsburg, those days. President now is right in this room. And the chief financial officer of Rockefeller University and me to go down and study a college which had offered the presidency to Jay Rockefeller. Well, I had visited a lot of colleges, so I knew how to do this. And we met with everybody at this college. And then we met with Jay Rockefeller. And we had to give him an opinion. And I learned for the first time how people when they're talking to someone whom they see as powerful, whether they are or not is irrelevant, they say to them what they think they want to hear. So the two men did pretty much that. And then I said, this is not, Mr. Rockefeller, a very good college. It's not good enough for you. It's got problems, and you know nothing about what you do for a college. Therefore, you're not good enough for it, which absolutely amazed him. And he phoned me the next week and said, I want to stay in West Virginia. I want to run for the Senate, and I have to be here, so I'm going to take the job. And I didn't say, why'd you waste our time coming down? Because he was going to take it.
So your assignment with the Rockefellers was to work with the cousins, was it?
My assignment was for a couple of years to get to know the family, the cousins primarily, the children of the Rockefeller brothers. You quickly learned you got to know everyone. And someone had been given that job, and the cousins didn't accept the person. So I worked for 2 years at the Rockefeller Brothers Fund to get to know the family, and then my job was to really teach the younger generation about, well, it turned out, everything.
And imagine that one of the young Rockefellers asked you, maybe they did, about your philosophy about philanthropy. Not asking you of a specific, should I give it to this, but generally, how to approach, or how they should approach philanthropy.
Well,
what would you say, or what did you say?
What I did, this was before computers, and every Rockefeller had what was called a blue book, and that had their philanthropy for the last 3 years with gifts. And so as I met with each one of them, and I traveled all over the country to meet the cousins, I would say, I've studied your blue book, and your philanthropic interest is. And it never, never was what the grant showed. And I said, well, this really isn't your interest? No, everything I do is because other people, friends, ask me for money. So I said, well, why don't you from now on, decide you have a budget. Every year, you're going to give a certain amount in response to your friends. And once you've done it, if it's all given away by February, you say, come back next year. And then let's talk about what you're really interested in. So it was a question. And a few things interested many of them. They, through me, became very influential in the beginning of NRDC, Natural Resources Defense Council, because I talked about it and many of them gave to it. So,
So you gave them good advice, very good advice, I think.
Yeah.
And you were close, I think, to, as you said, to JDR3, but also to Blanchett. And didn't you take a trip with her to Asia?
Yeah.
And that did that start your interest in Asia? Tell us about that trip.
Well, I knew her a little bit when her husband was alive. He died in a car accident. And a few months later, she was going to Asia because so many people had made gifts to the Asia Society in his memory. And she said, when you're talking about Asia, Japan, writing is not enough. I've got to go and thank them. So we went, and I got to know her on that trip and knew her very well, which is what I mean. I went to work with the cousins, but I spent more time with her than anyone and was with her till she died of Alzheimer's disease. But we had a great trip to Asia. By the end of it, I was exhausted. I wasn't used to dinner parties every night. And interestingly enough, Japan has changed. But then a dinner party would have the host, his wife, who almost never spoke English, Blanchette and me, and all men. Women did not have the role that I think they have now in Asia. But I love Japan.
We were together on an Asian Cultural Council trip in November. I think it was November, wasn't it, Miho? And we were in Taipei and Manila, and Elizabeth spoke and got a standing ovation in both places. So I was...
Asia loves old people. They do. I mean, you don't have to make any excuses for it.
Well,
so I was able to get up and talk, and I got a standing ovation, which if I'd been 40, would not have happened.
It's true. It's true that you got a standing ovation. A moment ago, you were telling a story of learning that people don't necessarily speak the truth to people of wealth or people representing wealth. If you were giving advice to somebody taking on the presidency of a large foundation, or even a young person going into being a program officer, what would you tell them on this question of hearing the truth?
Well, it doesn't matter what you say to people. They believe you if you're in a foundation. And they never tell you when you don't know what you're talking about. Never. They don't. But I've never really worked at a foundation. I've been on boards. I've often thought what I would do. This will never happen. If I had an area that I was interested in, population, I would find the best people globally working in that field, meet with them, pick the ones I thought were the most brilliant, and say, what's your strategy? Foundations create strategies in everything they're doing, and they don't always know what they're talking about. But if you got the best people and you said to them, this is your strategy, what do you need from this foundation? Who do you need to work with you? How much money? That's the way I do it. But I've loved the foundations I've been. We had a good time.
We did. You wrote a thoughtful letter to the MacArthur leadership in 1996, critiquing the foundation and really saying that it was doing too many things, making too many small grants, not giving enough unrestricted support. And then you said, and I quote, this is from your letter, it should be the task of the officers of the foundation to identify big bet opportunities. Only these will be remembered as having made a significant identifiable difference. The world, economically, politically, socially, has experienced an era of sea change comparable to the Industrial Revolution or even the Renaissance. Foundation should make grants. Those who analyze these new problems, it's time for fresh thinking and analysis. So looking back over the foundation world, not just MacArthur, What foundations do you think have done a good job in the last 20 years? What are some of the bright spots?
I don't know, but I think that many of them, the big ones, have done certain very good things. Remember the Green Revolution? That was Rockefeller Foundation.
Right.
But I remember saying, and I think it was at MacArthur, that this was, if a man from Mars came to a MacArthur Foundation meeting and spent 2 days with us and went back to Mars, he would tell his fellow Martians, you don't have to worry about planet Earth. MacArthur is taking care of it. And you changed that.
That was before my time, she made that comment.
And you did change that.
Thank you. Well, I did because I had good advice and strong support from you in doing it. We're going to open up in a moment to the audience. Let me just ask one last question about boards. You've been on a lot of boards. I mentioned them in the beginning, Asian Cultural Council, Juilliard, MacArthur, Sloan Kettering. What boards did you enjoy the most? And what makes for a good board and a good board chair? A lot of people here are on boards, and I think they'd love to hear your wisdom.
Well, I've been on all kinds of boards, and the one that is means most to me is Hamilton College.
Really?
Yes. It's a board of mostly people who love the college and who understand the role of a board. Many people talk to me about their board doesn't do anything. And I say, that's too bad. But worse is if they do the wrong thing. That is, try to manage. So Hamilton, I love Hamilton. And that's not simply because it is well governed, but it's a great college.
Final question before I open it up. You're involved in palliative care.
Right.
Not everybody knows what palliative care is. Tell us about it and what your role is. Are you chairman of the board of that, of the partnership?
Yeah. And the executive director, Kathy English, is right here. Palliative care is not well known enough. And it's supportive care. It's care that improves the quality of life, and it deals, among other things, with pain. The problem is that most people don't know what it is, but those who think they know confuse it with hospice, and where you're in at hospice, you get palliative care. You get as much comfort as they can give you when you're dying. But my position is, and the partnership's position, is that whenever a person is diagnosed with a serious illness, the doctor should also recommend a palliative care doctor to help the patient deal with, for instance, the chemotherapy that the patient is getting for cancer, to deal with that. So we're working hard to get it better known, and also to get doctors, cardiologists, and all other doctors to recommend it. Because it's very hard for some oncologists, for instance, to think that anyone other than they themselves could help a patient. And so We're working on it, and Kathy knows a lot about it.
So let's hope any of us, when we get into our early 90s, have the energy and determination and passion to take on a new challenge. Let's open it up to the audience. Just two requests. Please identify yourself and make it a short and a real question. Starting with Rita Hauser. And the mic is coming.
I can't help but ask you, and you can demur and not answer.
Rita, could you talk into the mic?
Sorry, Rita Hauser. I can't help asking you, Betty. You can refuse to answer, but I'd like to know, do you think the new pope will really change the tenor and quality of the Catholic Church, about which you know, I'm sure, far more than most of us here? And what do you think of the nuns who go on the bus and who shake up the boat a little bit, to mix some metaphors?
I think they're a great crowd, those nuns who are on the bus. I asked the president of Fordham that question. Can this interesting pope, an inspiring pope, do anything permanent? And the head of Fordham said, if he lives long enough to appoint many cardinals, that they can change the church, but he won't do it alone. I think he's a breath of fresh air. He's great.
Steve.
Steve Cass. I was a resident of Harrison when the president of Manhattanville College worked with Ed Logue to try and build some integrated housing in Purchase. As I recall, that did not go well, despite great efforts by you and Jerry Aron. And I wonder whether you have any recollections of that episode.
I don't think I did that, did I?
Yes, I think you were the president at the time.
Was I? It mustn't have turned out very well, because I forget it.
It engendered 1,000 people in opposition to your proposal and ended up amending the UDC Act so they didn't have override power.
Has it ever happened?
No. That's why I asked you.
Well, one more task to work on. Other questions this side of the room? Anybody? Okay, we have one back here on the aisle.
Talk to me about that.
Philip Kibitz, I'm a physician, and I applaud your movement to get palliative care recognized, which is very important because the diseases we thought used to be fatal are now thought to be chronic, as cancer now is becoming more treatable. The question is there payment for palliative care? Otherwise, how do patients attain it?
I couldn't hear.
The question is there insurance or some kind of payment for palliative care so that patients can afford it? And if there isn't, how do they do it?
People, Kathy, people are working on that, aren't they? It's.
There should be new forms of payment.
I want to give the mic to Kathy so we can get an answer.
Kathy knows.
Hi. So we hope that under the Affordable Care Act, healthcare providers will be paid differently. So instead of being paid for each individual injury that you have, you'll be paid for the patient and how you take care of them over the course of the year. And so palliative care then becomes much more attractive to insurers and to people in general, because lots of the things that you get through palliative care are not as expensive as some other things, but are more effective.
Good, thank you. We have a question back there in the middle.
Hi, Janice Schachter-Lentz. I was wondering, what inspired you to give out a MacArthur grant and the procedure of how you do it, which is a very unusual and inspiring way?
So as the MacArthur Fellowships, how did they work? The Genius Grants, your friend Dan Sokolow.
Yes.
How did it work? And
it's there is a staff, and there are nominators. And these nominators change every few years. And they nominate potential winners. And then they are discussed by the staff and by outside experts in the area. And of course, they're voted on by the board. But the board approves the list. Now and then, the board will say, this person has so much money from other grants or from whatever that this wouldn't matter. How much is it? It's 500.
Well, it's 500,000 now over 5 years.
Yeah, it's 100,000 a year, and it's people are allowed on the board. If you know someone who gets one, you may be the person. See, no one can apply for these grants. Therefore, getting it becomes a surprise when you get it. I remember I knew and still know Jacques D'Amboise, the dancer, and he got one. And I phoned him, and he was at rehearsal with school children, which is what he does. And I said, interrupt him. And he came, and he said exactly what you'd hope for someone who were giving this kind of grant. He said, Elizabeth, what's the problem? How can I help you? And I said, I'm calling to tell you you've just received a MacArthur grant. Not really, but it's called the Genius Grant, and you've gotten one. He said, really? I said, Jacques, I need your social security number. He said, do you think at this moment I know what my social security number is? It's a wonderful thing, yeah. And comes as a surprise. Yeah. To people.
Colin Campbell has a question over here. Former head of the Rockefeller Brothers Fund and now president of Colonial Williamsburg, and had something to do with Wesleyan University, which he was president for many years.
Elizabeth, there's a lot of criticism out there these days of philanthropy, where it's going, of the tax laws perhaps being too beneficial to philanthropy, both organized and individual. How do you see the future of American philanthropy and those kinds of pressures and criticisms that we're hearing today?
I don't think the deductible for philanthropy will change. And I think the danger, I think the churches will keep it from changing. The trouble is it might disappear except for churches. You know, which would be awful. I don't know. I don't follow it carefully, but I somehow have faith that it won't disappear. What do you think, Jonathan?
I agree with you. I think there may be talk of it, but I think the deduction will continue. But I also think that people give because they want to give. I'm not one who believes that people only give because they get a tax deduction for it. Other questions? Yes, right here on the aisle.
Sister, you come from a unique position with you're rubbing shoulders with great wealth, but coming from a religious background. I wonder, and I come from something of your background. How do you do, when you're in public, deal with women's issues within the Roman Church? In general,
how do you deal with women's issues within the Catholic Church, especially when you're in a public setting?
You see, I've never tried to take on the Catholic Church in any issue. I don't like to fail. And there. I think this Pope may think about that. I mean, I hope so. I was thinking of writing him, but not about the role of women, about celibacy. I think he has said that the rule about celibacy is not a matter of faith, It's a matter of practice and requirement, which could change. And I'm thinking of writing him. He'll never see it, but it would feel good to write him and say, you could change it. You're the Pope. But I don't know whether he will or not. But the role of women, I think, is improving, even in the church.
We'll take a couple more questions, Miho.
Miho runs the Asian Cultural Council.
Yes, I'm very honored to run the Asian Cultural Council, where Elizabeth is our chairman emeritus and Jonathan our trusted trustee. My question is, Elizabeth, I got to know you when we traveled together about a year ago, and as we were trying to promote the importance of cultural exchange and supporting individuals traveling to different countries and experiencing different cultures. And I noticed your passport was probably the thickest passport I've ever seen in my life, maybe 50 to 60 pages. In all your travels with the ACC and with the other foundation boards that you sit on, where has been the most interesting place to travel, and where do you think in the world, where in the world needs cultural exchange today?
Is that all? I don't think cultural exchange gets as much coverage as it should. It's so valuable. It's the reason that I find ACC so important. But exactly what did you ask?
Where would you like to travel?
Where are we going?
Where are we going?
We had such fun, because I no longer can do all of it. I get a wheelchair. And in Asia, they're not used to that, and there aren't easy access to wheelchairs. You can get in one, but then how do you get where you're going? And so I got into the hidden parts of airports, where someone would have to come and unlock a little elevator that the wheelchair would hardly fit in. And so I said to Miho, we should write a book about this trip, and it would be called The Terrorist in the Wheelchair. Because I got in everywhere, and nobody stopped us. And so, I don't know, but you name the place.
So she's saying she's ready to go. So last question, let me pose that. And Elizabeth, you've had a long and successful life, and you're still going with new ventures like palliative care and your book on wheelchair terrorism. What were the looking back on that long and wonderful life, what were the paths not taken? You thought about being a journalist at one point. If you had anything to do over again, what would it be?
I think thinking about that is a really waste of time.
I have this quote from Joel Fleischman about being blunt but respectful. And, anything you'd like to say that isn't a waste of time as a closing comment?
This is a great crowd.
It is. It is a great crowd.
They listen. They laugh. Yeah. It's great. I really would never have done this, ever, except Jonathan is my friend, and he asked me, and you don't say no to friends. So thank you all very much. It turned out to be fun.
Thank you, Elizabeth. It's been a great evening. Just a great evening. One of our best.